that audio, right, when you're listening azan, and that is true about that city and nobody can deny that, and that has been in my bloodstream. I mean, if I have to close my eyes and imagine Lucknow, that's the sound I hear.
Wow.
And I have put all of that in the film.
Hello and welcome to the Humans of Cinema podcast. My name is Harshit and today I have with me Mrs. Juhi Chaturvedi, the writer of films like Piku, October, Vicky Donor, all of which happen to be some of my favorite films of all time. Juhi, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Harshit. Happy to be here.
It's such a huge pleasure to have you because I can't even tell you how much I love all of your films, especially October and Piku are definitely some of my favorite films. And every person that I meet, especially when I talk to people cinephiles from outside of India, if I have to recommend them films from Hindi cinema, I always tell them to watch Piku and October.
My hemoglobin just shot up to 16.
No, not at all. I mean, you know, even on Humans of Cinema, so the idea of Humans of Cinema is that people write about their favorite films, people write about their favorite characters and the characters and films that have had the deepest influence on their life.
Right.
And I mean, I can't even tell you how many people write to me about Piku and October, especially.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible that you also may have seen some of them.
Yes. I tagged on Humans of Cinema post. Especially October, definitely.
You write about October, and the film has had such a deep influence on me as well. And has also helped me in times of grief, in tough times that I have been through in my life. So thanks a lot for writing these films.
Thank you.
So Juhi, I want to start off by asking you, if I had to ask you, what are such films for you? What is the one film or what are the few films that have had the deepest influence on your life? What would you say?
You know, it's not just any one particular film.
If it has to be a couple of films,
like for example, of course, Ray. Satyajit Ray's work, that for me is when I really started paying attention into, you know, the world of filmmaking, cinema and all of that. Before that, you know, of course, like anybody else, I had also consumed similar content like Hrishikesh Mukherjee or Basu Chatterjee or Sai Paranjpeji, all of them, you know, Saeed Mirza, in fact. Yeah, Saeed Mirza, again, you know, his work has impacted me quite a bit. So it's only when I started looking at movies more from an understanding of life and what these prolific filmmakers were actually trying to say. So these films have really, their films have really impacted me quite a bit. Bicycle Thief, everybody keeps talking about it, and sorry to be repetitive, but it does every time. Within and you just can't stop crying because it pushes you to that level of that corner of yourself where you just question the most basic thing, that relationship between father and son, that absolute need to portray himself as a kind, good, honest man. And all in the eyes of a child, you know, how does it matter, right? You can fool the child, but just imagine the desperation of that father and how he, you know, that end of that film, I mean, every time I watch, I cry. And it's a masterclass in humanity, in being a human, I feel.
Absolutely.
Forget writing. I mean, writing is one part of it, or filmmaking is one part of, you know, all these films. But these films are beyond cinema. These films are beyond anything. These are, life lessons. These are literature that one must read and pass it on to next generation.
Absolutely. And, you know, these are some qualities that I have observed in your cinema as well. Even your cinema and the films that you have written are also extremely human. They're also about human relationships. They're also all the characters that you've written, they are so deeply involved in the people around them. Do you think that being inspired from filmmakers like Ray or filmmakers like Vittorio De Sica has eventually led you to write your films also in this way?
I mean, it definitely must be affecting me in lot of levels without me knowing them consciously. But there was me before I started writing movies, right? There was a childhood, yeah. There was a parenting, there was an environment that I grew up, there were conversations at home, which were, I would say for me, they have been great influences in my life. Whatever I feel I am today is a lot to do with the environment I was brought up in. You know, basic things of life, that do not judge people, do not go out and just start commenting unless and until you know. In fact, don't even comment unless you are asked, right? It's all right. You've done your bit. Leave it to God. You just be on the right path. You know, things, basic, small, day-to-day conversations on the dining table. So what are you planning to do today? Okay, Papa, I have XYZ plan. Okay, if you want to do this, do. But I would say do this, and if you need help, I'm there. But you will have to do it yourself. You know, that constant support that was coming from behind, that you ultimately have to face, we are there. We are giving you the knowledge, but you will have to filter it out as per the situation, whatever life throws at you. I mean, whether it was, amongst the friends or relatives, or whether it was from the people who were sort of, helping us run the house, whether it was house helps or whether it was a rickshawala or whether it was the doodwala or, Lucknow being a certain kind of a small town where you interact extremely closely with these people. They are not, though there is a division, class division, there is an upper class, lower class, all of that did exist, but somehow we were still together as one and same. Right. So hours of conversations with, just this old lady in my house, and one would get a glimpse into their world. What drives them? You know, why are they so righteous and so honest in spite of the poverty that has affected them
and taken over their life.
Correct. So all that has been hugely inspiring for me. And I feel that, those have been my life lessons that somehow just stick on the path and just keep doing.
Dewey, you've written so many films that have been based in Delhi, and I think this is the first time that you've written a film which is based in your hometown, Lucknow. Do you think that this film, in a way, is the most personal film that you've written? Or not?
Yeah, to some extent, definitely. See, because Delhi, it's like, I just love Delhi. It's north, it's food, it's people, it's weather, it's all of that. And I started working in that city, so sort of financial freedom was there. I was living on my own for the first time, so that kind of adventure was there. My friends were there. It was more of an identity that was I was trying to create for myself. So it was a different experience with the city, and therefore the thrill is a lot more. With Lucknow, it's a relation. It's like a parent. It's like a I was born there. So whether it's the cultural influence, the historical influence, or the geographical influence, the importance of gumti, gumti mein pani bad gaya hai, gumti mein pani kam ho gaya hai. These are very important conversations.
You have incorporated all of these little elements in your script.
Yes, I have, because this is what I know. But again, not everything about Lucknow, because Lucknow, what is relevant from the film's point of view, right? My experience in that city, of course, starts from the day one I was born till today. But everything can't be relevant for the film. However, there's an audio, of the city. I've grown up with that. Like, there was a Hanuman Mandir very close to my house, which 5:30 in the morning, they would every day play Hari Om Sharan Bhajan. But at the same time, extremely closely, there was this masjid in a location called Chandganj. So basically, azan used to happen over there. And the Hari Om Sharan and azan used to clash every morning when we would get up in the morning to study for your exams or whatever, to finish your homework. And that audio, right, when you're listening azan, and that is true about that city, and nobody can deny that, and that has been in my bloodstream. I mean, if I have to close my eyes and imagine Lucknow, that's the sound I hear.
Wow.
And I have put all of that in the film.
I think it's very interesting that the fact that you mentioned the audio of the city, because I think we don't realize how important the sounds of a city are until we actually get away from it and then think about what we miss the most about the city. And I think a lot of us actually think about the sounds more than anything else.
Correct. Late at night, deep at night, winter night I'm talking about, Harshit, there used to be this Makhan Malai Wala who around 10:30, 11, and in 10:30, 11, or maybe even at 9, you know, winter night, it's pretty late, he would go around doing his rounds selling Makhan Malai. Anybody from Lucknow will tell you what it sounds, because perhaps it seems like we were the only one in the whole city. Don't know, there would have been many. But we know that at night, when the Makhan Malai guy used to pass, we used to feel very safe that things are fine, all right, outside.
Right.
You know, it was a comfort. It was a security of a child that, okay, it's around 9 o'clock at night. That means it's not yet the time to get scared, because at night all of us would be scared.
Yeah, wow. Juhi, where did the idea of Gulabo Sitao specifically come from? Like this idea of two people fighting over a piece of land and this kind of two oddballs at loggerheads with each other. How did this idea come to you?
See, again, like all our previous films, ideas come from life, from our own experiences, from the people we've met, from the people we've heard about, from our own, like I have always lived, sorry to sound as a privileged person, but yeah, we were the landlords and we had tenants in the house and
right.
So I've seen that relationship. Sometimes it was very friendly, sometimes it was like, you know, are they just going to the court? So, you know, like the pump getting you know, spoiled, which I used in Piku, you know, when Rana is called to mend the pump.
Yeah.
So things like that would happen on a daily basis. Who uses the lawn? Who will be, you know, who will lock the door, the main gate? Are you allowed to ring the bell? Not allowed to ring the bell? So many things tenants go through at a very daily basis. When the water supply will come, the electricity bill, the water bill. I mean, it's crazy. So I've grown up with that. Whose responsibility is it? You know, when you when things go wrong in your apartment, in a tenant's apartment, of course, a landlord is supposed to do all those things. But at that time, maybe those things were not so well chalked out, right? That's another part of it. You know, we all, I mean, in our country, either you are living in your own house or you are living in a
rented house.
Right. That's that much to it. But beyond that, you know, that's one small part of it. But beyond that, we are talking about people, about human beings. Human beings in a certain strata of the society who are struggling to make their ends meet, right? Not just from this film's point of view, in general, the life struggle is very harsh, and we end up taking certain decisions, doing certain things in a manner just so that we can survive, just so that we can, you know, say that, okay, tomorrow also I will have this roof on me, right? When you look at from that lens, everything seems justified, though it is wrong at a very very universal level. Of course, a lot of things are wrong, but if you see from that lens, from that person's lens, sab theek lagta hai. So without judging it, just trying to understand it, and it is a satire. Satires are not easy, but that's what our job is, to understand life from its irony. And in a way that it's not only there to affect or change me individually, but can it, you know, affect the society at large, right? So all those things have been kept in mind while, you know, the idea or the conversation of Gulabo Sitabo started. So Mirza is one such crooked fellow without passing a judgment on his character. I have done everything possible to make him true to his circumstances.
Right.
Or Bake, or whoever else. I mean, there are so many people in the film. When you see everybody,
Vijayaraj's character also seemed so interesting from whatever I saw in the trailer.
It is because ultimately we are all, it's a whirlpool, life struggle, and we are all sucked into it. That's the truth of it.
Yeah.
And that's all we've tried to you know, bring out. You know, of course, the tone is humor because I like humor. And
yeah.
That's best tool. But if you look at it at a slightly, you know, from a distance, I hope that it will connect with you, you know, in a way that you've sort of tried to.
Dewey, so I'm an aspiring writer as well. And as an aspiring, as a writer myself, one thing that I struggle with a lot is that, I mean, I think I would like to believe that I'm a good observer, which is why I, in the first place, thought about becoming a writer. But also when I actually sit down to write, I've seen that I struggle with actually thinking of those instances that I very well observed at that point and thought that, you know, I would like to sort of incorporate this in some script, but then I forget about it. So like, For example, you mentioned the scene in which Rana fixes the hand pump, and you're saying that you have seen that kind of, you've observed it from your real life. So what is your process when you see such scenes or when you see such things in your real life? Do you write them down immediately, or do you happen to have a good memory?
No. See, thing is, what happens, this, for example, the pump scene. Now, this I'm talking about somewhere in 80s, okay? When I was in Lucknow as a kid, and we had these tenants, and these issues used to happen very often. Now, these are those memories which are there, you know, imprinted. Now, I mean, I have always felt that my first reference point or my first source of material is my own life. I go back that many years, however many years it requires, and just start reliving. Kya hota tha? Kya hota tha? Wo log kya karte the? Hum kya karte the? Pados mein kya hota tha? Unke ghar mein kya hota tha? Sab kuch. You know, that is a material. And material not in a negative way, I'm saying, not in a very transactional way, I'm saying. But, you know, see, those were the things. Why they are there in your memory? Because even at that point in time, you must have found it quirky. What goes on? What is this damn to look on this pump thing? That off, and it looks funny and it makes a weird sound and everybody is standing around it and chala pani aaya chada nahi chada kya ho raha hai, and then one kind of a electrician would come and with his wrench and, you know, and suddenly pani ka phuvara niklega, you know, it was a drama. Phir lal color ka patta bandh rahe. Now those memories I have as a child, right? I'm just, no matter what the subject I choose, believe me, if it's coming from life, somewhere in some form or the other, or your idea, if it's coming from, you know, your life around or your friends or whatever, somewhere you would have definitely experienced in your childhood something that it has stayed inside you and now it's coming to you as an idea. But there will always be something that our own lives can at least initiate, you know. You don't have to write everything that you've experienced. Not at all. I'm not saying that your memories only will become the film. Absolutely not.
Of course,
biopic. But that can be a trigger point.
Absolutely.
That can just, so I feel that in times of crisis, the best thing one can do is albums, photo albums of yourself, of your family, of your friends. You know, they do inspire us. You know, see, the moment you look at a picture of 1992. It's not just a picture that you're looking. You suddenly remember the location. How did you get to that location? What was it? What was the weather? Did mom and dad have an argument before that? What was that argument? You know, it just opens a Pandora box, right?
Yeah.
And I'm just speaking as another fellow writer or a thinker, that these are the things that I do when I am in absolute. No,
that's actually very helpful. I actually never thought about something like that at all.
कहीं दो जाने की ज़रूरत नहीं पड़ती, I feel.
Juhi, so, you know, Aaron Sorkin is another one of my...
Right.
Besides you, Aaron Sorkin is another one of my favorite screenwriters. It also happens to be his birthday today, by the way.
Oh, lovely.
So I was just seeing this interview of Aaron Sorkin's where he was saying that he needs a happy mindset in order to right? Like if he's having a bad day, not even a bad day, if even one bad thing has happened in the day, for example, let's say his daughter had an issue at her school, or he had a small argument with his wife, he is done for the day. He can't write anymore.
Yeah.
So do you have that kind of problem as well? Do you need a specific mindset in order to be able to write?
I definitely have to be in a slightly la la land happy space zone too, because what happens, I mean, now what you're telling me about him, that's the end of the day, productivity of the day, because what must be happening to him, because that does happen to me, is that if there's an argument, then all your energy and your thinking and everything, investigation, mind, mood, everything gets stuck in that. It's like, you know how sometimes a fish gets stuck in the corner of the, you know, on the riverbed, edge of the river on the side, till another wave comes and pushes you backward into the flow. Otherwise, you know, you get stuck there. So you just get stuck there, that why did he say that? Why did she do that? What happened? You forget about everything else. That itself becomes your topic or the subject.
Yeah.
Right. So obviously, how are you going to, because it affects you. That's why you get stuck. See, and it'll be only happening because it's coming from people who matter to you. An argument with a friend or a discussion which hasn't ended well, you are going to dwell into it. So how are you going to write something completely different? But what happens, what the beauty is, that I think next time, much later in life, if you're writing about a husband-wife squabble or a relationship with a friend which has gone sour or whatever, you'll go back to that. You had got stuck and you were not writing what you were supposed to write.
Yeah.
So it's all right, I feel.
Okay. Achha, Juhi, one more thing. Yeah. So, for example, since you started back in the day and to now, that you have given so many successful films, do you think that that the responsibility that you attach to yourself as a writer, or the expectation that you attach with yourself as a writer, has changed with now that you've given films like Pico and October, which have been super successful, and now that you know that so many people look up to your films and kind of get inspired by them?
See, I'll be very honest that even in advertising days, we were fairly responsible and answerable, very important word, answerable, for whatever we were writing or sharing with the clients or with our bosses, or, you know, saying that it was my idea and all that. It was a fairly transparent it was very clear environment, work environment, and we were questioned for everything or grilled for everything that we produced as ideas, because because you know, you can't just sell an idea to a client at a very surface level. You would have done your groundwork, you would have thought about it, you would have come up with a particular idea, knowing your target audience, knowing your buyer, knowing the history, geography, civics of that consumer, everything. So that much goes into coming up with a 30 seconder also. Forget a 2-hour feature film. I'm saying even a 30 second is a hugely responsible job. You cannot just go and produce and rattle off something in front of the client just like that. It's a huge responsibility that that you have been given in a working environment in a company, because you're representing a company. It is a big thing. So at some point in time, I did leave advertising and I started on my own, writing on my own. But that grooming has not gone. I mean, when I was taking my 30-seconder scripts to Shajit, I was not going there just as Juhi. I was going as a representative of Ogilvy & Mather.
Right.
So it's a company name. And he was interacting not just with me as a writer, but also as a company, as a client. He was taking that responsibility. So that relationship or that method of working has continued. Today, there is no Ogilvy & Mather behind me. But the responsibility, or I'm still answerable for everything that I write, and I put my neck out there for every word out there. My name coming over there does not mean, oh, I'm getting recognition. That's no reason to put your name out there. For me, name out there means I am equally responsible in this project as Ronnie Lahiri, as Shijit Sarkar, as anyone else. And I'm taking full responsibility for everything. So has it changed over a period of time? No, I have, in fact, no. When I say no, I mean it has only and only made me realize the importance of it even more.
Right.
That, yeah. You know, that the purpose of your writing or your recognition is not ki, oh, everybody will know my name or whatever. It's much bigger.
Yeah.
And but therefore, it must, therefore my written work, I have to, what should I say? I'm the biggest critique of my work. I have to read it again and again, judge everything, eliminate, which is not serving the purpose of the vision, working towards the vision of the film. And once all of that is done, then it becomes a process where Shijit starts honing it, shining it, you know, purifying it further. But before that, whatever I write, and I'm writing whether for him or for anybody else, it is my neck out there, yes.
Yeah. Julie, you had posted something on Instagram yesterday that I found very interesting. I thought that we'll talk about this. You had written that at what point writing ends, direction begins, actors take over, camera glorifies, music flows in, cinema tells the story, not the above. What exactly did you mean by this? Like, how did you think about writing this?
Right. So, it's like, a story or a film or cinema. The purpose, I feel, is to reach out to the hearts of people. It's a voice, okay? It's a very sensorial experience. It could be a pertinent thought that I go and plant in your head. It could be an emotional experience. You may cry, you may laugh or whatever. It is not about dissecting who wrote what. Did he direct it like this? I'm saying when the end product is ready, it has to be an experience. It's a feeling. It must be consumed as a feeling, not as a product.
Yeah, completely makes sense. Yeah.
You know, at what point the music, you must, because when you're listening to the conversations, while the music is there, but it should not tell you that the music is there. There is a camera, but camera should not say that, look, I'm going so close to Aishman's nose or Mirza's nose at this point in time. It should all happen so seamlessly. It's like a beautiful, it's a beautiful melody where you don't know at what point the instrument begins, ends, starts. All you remember, all you should do is just consume it and be affected by it. And actors, at what point the actor becomes the character becomes a believable person. That's so, it's like life itself, you know. It just starts as a small little thing. When the when the nails start developing, when the hair come, when the eyelashes come, when the point is a beautiful baby is born, right?
Yeah. So Juhi, I just want to end this conversation with one last question.
Right.
And it is that, how exactly do you develop characters? Like, do you have this idea in mind? For example, for a film like Piku, would you sketch out a character of Piku and Rana separately first, or would you think of the story first and then individually sketch out the characters, think of a stories around, think of their backgrounds, character tree around them? How exactly do you develop your characters?
See, the basic idea, basic plot, or basic understanding that what are you going to say in this particular film that of course is there. That comes number one, right? What I'm going to write towards. But it's not like that I start writing those 100 line or one liners, you know, people write. I don't follow that. I don't write at this point. I mean it's just a vague idea. It's just there somewhere in conversations. We know what we are writing or working towards. Who will be the people? Where will it be set up? What is the milieu? What is the environment? What is the educational qualification of this person? In which area of the city he has grown up? In which part of the city? Which school did he go to? Did he have siblings? No, was his mother alive to influence him? Or he grew up without parents? You know, all those things about the character, that's where my entire time goes, actually. In building up, in knowing them, and knowing them inside out, that at some point in time, that there is no imagination, they become real for me. Right? When I have all of that, then the typing process begins, or some few things here and there I'll type. But till then, it's only in that environment, in that basic plot line, whatever I have, whatever the thought is there, within that, it's important who those people are. Like, again, you know, you have gone to school, I have gone to school, but your experience of school and my experience of school will be completely different because of the friends you made, because of the teachers you experienced, because of the teachers that I experienced. You know, so my world, school life, would be very different from you. And for me, it is important who are my friends, who are my teachers. It's not just school. You know what I'm saying? It has to be completely known to me. And then I feel my work becomes really easy. Then these people themselves start driving it for me. It's really, and it really, I mean, believe it or not, but I do feel that they do sit around me and tell me, come on, ye to main bol hi nahi sakta. What are you typing?
I can completely, I mean, I can imagine something like that happening.
It happens to me, really.
No, especially for a film like Pico, I've seen the film just keeps flowing, and it almost feels like it just because of how well the characters are written, that the film is just taking itself forward almost. Like, it doesn't even feel like.
Also, what happens, like, you know, like, for example, because all my films, Shujit has.
Directed,
and he's made them into what they are today. You know, but I feel his own experiences of life. See, if you hear him speak about his Hashimara days, about those jungles where he grew up, about you know, when his father was in the Air Force, the elephants that used to come. Now, you know, those are the memories, and they've continued, whether it was his drama days in Delhi or various postings. So, you know, we are all discussing a lot of things all the time. Now, everything is not to put in a film, but it is also to enrich each other. You know, so that tomorrow when I'm stuck and if I have to think of some reference, I say, I think he was telling me something like this, and let me dwell more on that. That becomes a trigger point for me. So what is very important, I think, for writers, directors, filmmakers, is to have very, have a lot of conversations. You know, film likhna, direct karna, ye ek technicality ho jata hai, wo ho jayega. If you're, somewhere there, your craft will happen, right? Before that, your thought is more important. I think that needs to be, that has lot more value for me. Likhna, gana, acting karna, direct karna, wo sab kuch, that's part of the job, and we all over a period of time become good at it and start doing it well. What we cannot do, if we don't do it consciously, is evolve. And that is what conversations, good conversations, do. They help you evolve as people. And that for me is the basic is a prerequisite for a film, is a lot of good thoughts, a lot of interesting thoughts, a lot of new thoughts, a lot of insights. That your craft doesn't teach you, that only your personal endeavor.
That life teaches you. And
yeah, and your personal endeavor. And your endeavor. Your effort to constantly not give up on that. You know, the research on life cannot end. Yeah. Till the time you are alive, you will be facing it every day, and you cannot stop dwelling on it. You have to dwell on life, actually. Detach, yes, but live it also.
Yeah. Well, what I can tell you is that this conversation has definitely helped me in evolving in a lot of ways, and I'll definitely be thinking about a lot of things after this ends. And anyway, thank you so much, Juhi.
Thanks, Harsha.
This has been a great conversation. And all the best for Gulabo Sutabo.
Thanks.
And I'm really looking forward to watching the film. And hopefully I can send you a message after watching the film and let you know how much I loved it again after all the films that I loved of yours.
I will look forward to it, Harshit.
Thank you so much, Juhi.
Thanks.
And thank you everybody who joined in, who listened to the podcast. And yeah, keep listening and keep watching cinema. Thank you, guys. Bye.
Bye.